Unless you've been living underneath a rock, you guys probably know who Kevin O'Leary is, from his multiple appearances on Shark Tank, to his other business dealings, to how he sold a company and made billions of dollars. But you may not have known that Kevin O'Leary loves dividend stocks, which means I love Kevin O'Leary. In fact, Kevin O'Leary likes dividend stocks so much that he created his own dividend exchange traded fund, the O'Shares US Quality Dividend ETF, ticker symbol OUSA. And Mr. Kevin O'Leary believes that he has found the gold standard when it comes to the right quality large cap and mid cap dividend paying stocks, that he can outperform other dividend ETFs and individual quality dividend stocks. To which I say, challenge accepted. In this video, I promise to give you the most comprehensive review of the OUSA, O'Shares US Quality Dividend ETF. And just like in my other videos, guys, we're gonna take OUSA, its actual historical data, its historical dividend payments, its dividend growth, and we're gonna compare it against not only the S&P 500, but we're also gonna compare it against the Average Joe dividend portfolio. It's an all-out war between the Average Joe dividend portfolio, the S&P 500, and Mr. O'Leary's Mr. Wonder dividend portfolio. I can barely contain my own excitement here before we go over this data here, so make sure you hit the like button, hit the subscribe button. Let's get started. Hey guys, before we get started, make sure to hit that subscribe button below the video to ensure you do not miss any future videos I post. Make sure to leave a comment below saying you subscribed, and I promise to respond personally to your comment. All right guys, you know how much I value your time and how I never want to waste it, so let's go ahead and jump right into the content here. In this video, we're talking about the O'Shares OUSA Large Cap Quality Dividend ETF. And you know that I've been talking a lot about dividend stocks, and I've proven, I believe, that quality dividend stocks have the potential to beat not only the S&P 500, but also dividend exchange traded funds. But that dividend ETFs can be a great solution for those that want to earn dividend income, but also don't want to have to pick quality dividend stocks and manage them over time. I can totally see that perspective. So when another one comes along here like OUSA, I've got to give it a deep dive here and understand whether this is better than some of the other dividend ETFs out there. We're gonna see how OUSA compares to the S&P 500 SPY and how it compares to the Average Joe dividend portfolio. So in case you're brand new to the channel, welcome by the way. I have my own Average Joe dividend stock portfolio where I pick quality dividend stocks, and I've proven in previous videos, which I will link to below in the description, how my quality dividend stocks can outperform the S&P 500. They actually have outperformed the S&P 500 and outperformed other dividend ETFs as well. So I've got 19 different dividend stocks in the portfolio, and those are pictured here, which by the way, if you wanna be a member of the Patreon community, which I'll link in the description below, you can get access to my dividend portfolio, as well as a monthly updated list of quality dividend stocks that have been raising their dividends for at least 5 consecutive years. As you can see here, this took a lot of time to gather all of the data for all of the dividend stocks, get all the price history, the dividend history, all this information. And as you can see down here, part of the criteria we're looking at is two different scenarios. The first is where we're making monthly contributions where with $400 a month, and if you have access to this spreadsheet in the Patreon community, you can actually change this number here and it will actually automatically change the results for you as well by changing the monthly contribution. Additionally, we've got a second scenario here. Actually, I should name that scenario number two, not scenario number one. Shame on me. We've also got scenario number two here, where we are taking a lump sum starting amount of $250,000. I appreciate that not everybody has $250,000. In fact, most people don't. I certainly don't. But for those of you that are closer to retirement that have a large nest egg and you're thinking about transitioning over to dividend stocks, this will be a more relatable, hopefully, video where you can see what your money would do instead of making monthly contributions and starting from zero like we're doing in scenario number one. We're taking scenario two, no monthly contributions, just taking a lump sum, putting it in and seeing how it performs. We'll look at the shares owned at the end of the period. We'll look at the trailing 12 months of dividends after the 10th year, which by the way, that's what we're looking at, 10 years here. We're looking at what we think will happen in the future from 2021, as you can see right here, through 2031. 2021 through 2031. We make some assumptions based on the compound annual price growth rate and the compound annual dividend growth rate. Looking at the entire price history of the stock and the ETF, looking at the entire dividend history and saying, what's the compound annual growth rate of the price as well as the actual dividend as well. And then based on those metrics, we then project outward on a straight line assumption. Again, that's the nature of projecting. We don't know. Obviously, in real life, stock prices are gonna go up and down, up and down, up and down. But they're gonna go up over the long term. data and history have proven that, but we can't model that, unfortunately. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna say, what is the historical growth? And we're going to do a straight line growth, which is not realistic, but it's the best we can come up with. And we're doing an apples to apples comparison. We're doing that with all of my dividend stocks individually, all 19 of them, took a lot of time. And we're doing that with the S&P 500 ETF, and we're doing it with OUSA. Based on the data we had available to us, SPY had an annual compound growth rate from a price perspective of 13.15%. Now, this is not the entire history of SPY. This was based on the history only for OUSA. That's important to understand here. So what we knew is we wanted to compare apples to apples. We know that we've had a significant bull market over the past 5 to 10 years. So it wouldn't be fair to only use those years for OUSA, but use the entire history for the S&P 500 or my own dividend stocks. So what we did is we took only the price history that was applicable for OUSA. So we know that OUSA has been in existence since August of 2015. Since O-Shares Quality Dividend ETF has been in existence since August of 2015, we only used the price history for that ETF from August of 2015, but we only used August of 15 for SPY and for my quality dividend stock portfolio. Meaning that for SPY, we had a compound annual growth rate of 13% during that time frame for the price and a 4.63% compound annual growth rate for the 5-year return on the dividend growth rate. And then for OUSA, we've got a 5-year compound growth rate for the dividend of 7.78% and a compound annual price growth of 8.45%. So what exactly is OUSA, the O-Shares US Quality Dividend ETF? So Kevin O'Leary created a dividend ETF because he loves dividends. He's talked about in the past why he loves stocks that pay a dividend because it's a way to reward shareholders and also to actually get a return, a physical return on your investment rather than just hoping that it will continue to innovate, a stock will continue to innovate, and then hopefully just pay out through capital appreciation. According to the website for oshares.com, why OUSA for large cap quality dividends? Well, there's quality advantages. They seek companies with strong balance sheets and profitability for long-term investors. Performance. High quality dividend paying companies provide a performance alternative to value investing and a diversified portfolio. Approximately 100 major companies selected according to measures of financial quality. So the fund seeks to track the performance before fees and expenses of its target index, the O'Shares US Quality Dividend Index, which I think is hilarious, by the way, because you know, I could just make my own index up as well. You know, the average Joe quality dividend portfolio is based on trying to track an index, also known as the average Joe quality dividend index. So they say here clearly the objective, the target index is designed to measure the performance of publicly listed large cap and mid cap dividend paying issuers in the United States that meet certain market cap criteria, liquidity, high quality, low volatility, and dividend yield thresholds as determined by the company. So you can see right here, some of the top holdings in here are Microsoft, Johnson & Johnson, Home Depot, Procter & Gamble, Merck & Company, Verizon, Cisco, Apple, Pfizer, Honeywell. There are 101 different holdings here. And you can see that information technology makes up 22.75%, healthcare makes up 22.7%, and then we've got consumer staples, industrials, and consumer discretionary. Now, one thing that's very interesting, as you can see right here, OUSA pays a monthly dividend, whereas SPY pays a quarterly dividend, the S&P 500, and my own quality dividend portfolio technically has a monthly dividend, really. But ultimately, the majority, I think every company in there except for Realty Income pays a quarterly dividend. So we'll see how that impacts our results as well. One thing to know here is that OUSA does have an expense ratio, as you can see on the screen, 0.48%. So hypothetically, if you had 10,000 invested, actually let's say it this way, 250,000, because that's one of the lump sum opportunities here. Times 0.48% would be $1,200 every year that it would cost to be invested in this ETF. Now you should know here that the price history does incorporate this expense ratio. So we are building in the expense ratios here in our analysis. All right, let's take a look at the results here. So we've got, like I said, two different scenarios. The first is where we're making monthly contributions of $400 a month, and we're projecting out what is going to happen from 2021 through 2031 for 10 years. And then the second scenario does not involve any monthly contributions. Instead, we're starting with a lump sum of money, $250,000, and seeing if we invested that in these three different options, the average Joe portfolio, the S&P 500 ETF, or Kevin O'Leary's OUSA, we would see which one comes out ahead there. We'll look at the shares owned for the ETFs. We'll look at the trailing 12 months of dividends. And to be clear here, when I say the trailing 12 months of dividends, what I'm talking about is in year 10, what has the past year of dividends been? Okay, so on the 10th year, 12 months of annual dividend income? And then lastly, what's the overall value of the portfolio? Like I mentioned in previous videos, for my average Joe portfolio, I'm assuming equal weighting amongst the 19 different dividend stocks in the portfolio, whereas I don't actually do that in real life. I actually give a little bit more weighting to the higher dividend payers. So for example, ARCC and WLKP, AbbVie, they're getting more like 6 or 7% of the portfolio, whereas some of the lower dividend payers like Johnson & Johnson and McDonald's are getting 3 or 4%. So it's not quite representative of what I can accomplish in my own portfolio, but just for the sake of modeling, I went with just an equal weighting in my own portfolio. All right, let's first take a look at the actual scenario number 2 here with the starting lump sum value. Okay, so lump sum value, let's assume first, let's take a look at the number of shares. Let's go ahead and unmask that. All right, so we got shares owned for, I didn't actually do shares owned for my portfolio because it's like, you know, 19 different dividend stocks. But for the S&P 500, you would have, after the period was over, 697 different shares of SPY. And then for OUSA, we would have, for Mr. Wonderful, we'd have 8,526 different shares of that ETF. Let's take a look at trailing 12 months of dividends here. All right, boom. Shut the front door. You look at those numbers right there. Again, we're assuming $250,000 in lump sum. At the end of the 10th year, my portfolio, the average Joe portfolio, would be yielding $43,000 a year in dividend income. That's so much more than the S&P 500 at $6,000 and Kevin O'Leary's portfolio at $13,044. Now, to be clear here, Kevin O'Leary doubled the dividend income from the S&P 500, but I mean, I blew away Kevin O'Leary. I mean, Mr. Wonderful, where you at, man? All right, let's take a look at the total value here. Total value is interesting here. So again, we're assuming a lump sum here of $250,000 at the start. After 10 years, we would have, my portfolio would have $747,000, give or take. For Kevin O'Leary's Mr. Wonderful portfolio, we've got $726,000. And then for SPY, we'd have $1 million. Very interesting here. And now, one of the things I want to make sure we're aware of is we had to make some assumptions with the price data, and we only used price data from August of 2015 through present. And we had a price growth for SPY of 13%. Now, I don't think that SPY can replicate that over another 10 years, but I can't really model exactly what would happen with SPY in the future. So we're assuming 13% growth, which is why the value is so high there. But it did perform better on this apples to apples comparison. Now, one thing to consider here is you would have, under this scenario, this hypothetical scenario, you would have more money from SPY, but if your goal was to generate cash flow, if that's your goal, if your goal is just to have capital appreciation and pull money out, well, then you definitely have a better scenario with SPY at $1 million. But if you're looking to live off the cash flow, the question then becomes, can you then turn that $1 million portfolio and then buy assets that are yielding cash flow similar to what mine is? I'm yielding $43,000. I don't have to sell. I can live off $43,000. Let's just assume here, we're making some assumptions here. Let's say you could then turn that portfolio, you've got $1 million. Could you then turn that portfolio and swing it into a cash paying dividend portfolio? Let's say we wanted to turn that $1 million from SPY and then flip it into an OUSA portfolio and then take that $1 million and buy only just OUSA, the quality dividend ETF. Under this assumption, the price per share would be $85.23 as of February of 2031, based on our assumptions. And the annual dividend income we are assuming would be 0.158 times 12 would be annual dividends of $1.89 per share of dividend income. And we would divide that by the price per share of $85.23. Dividend yield of 2.22% based on our hypothetical scenario. If we multiply that by the portfolio, 1 million, we'd only be getting $22,000 in dividend income, which would be better than what you would get if you had invested with OUSA the whole time. 22,000 here, let me come back over here and look at what we had in our results. So we had 13,000 here, we'd have 22, so that would be better than investing in Kevin O'Leary's Mr. Wonderful portfolio during that entire 10 years, but you wouldn't be able to generate enough dividend income to outpace what I was already yielding with my portfolio. So the goal is capital appreciation under this hypothetical scenario, then you'd wanna go with SPY, but if you wanted to go with cash flow, you definitely want to go with my portfolio. I'm just saying. Okay, let's look at scenario number 1 here, where we're looking at monthly contributions of $400 a month over those 10-year period. Okay, starting from $0, $400 a month into the Mr. Wonderful portfolio, then we've got $400 a month into the S&P 500, and then $400 a month equally weighted into my 19 quality dividend stocks here. Let's see what the results would be from a shares perspective. Let's go ahead and unmask. Actually, we'll just do shares and trailing 12 months at the same time. We'd have $6,660 in trailing 12 months of dividend income versus only $669 for the S&P 500 versus $1,666 for Kevin O'Leary's portfolio. So again, the average Joe dividend portfolio outperforming from a dividend perspective. But what happens based on the total value? Let's take a look here. S&P 500, again, still outperforming because of that growth rate of 13%. And I'm still beating Kevin O'Leary's portfolio. We've got $98,979 on top. Then we've got $95,000 for Kevin O'Leary's portfolio. Then $115,000 for SPY. And then just to be clear here, if we wanted to then flip this portfolio of $115,000 and see how much income we could generate, 115,023.75 times 0.0222. only generating $2,553 in annual dividend income. So again, better than the Kevin O'Leary portfolio, but not as good as the average Joe dividend portfolio. Say what? Drop the mic. Before any of the haters jump in the comments below and say, well, you know what? You didn't incorporate taxes into this scenario. Yes, I know I didn't incorporate taxes. It's very difficult to do. Plus, we've talked about, you know, qualified dividends versus non-qualified, all the different factors that go into dividend income, but it's apples to apples here. We've got SPY, Average Joe, and Kevin O'Leary. And yes, the other haters will say that, well, you know what? Of course you can pick the dividend stocks, you know, based on what's happened in the past, but what if your dividend stocks don't perform? I get that. But what I can tell you is that my methodology for picking quality dividend stocks is better than most people's, in my own humble opinion. I've got very strict criteria. I don't go chasing yield. I don't go with just only dividend champions. I have a very measured approach based on dividend yield, based on dividend growth rate, based on the dividend payout ratio, free cash flow, not net income, and based on the history of dividend paying stocks, I feel like I can pick quality dividend stocks and manage those dividend stocks to where I can continue to see growth over time and also avoid dividend cuts. So long story short here, should you invest in Kevin O'Leary's Mr. Wonderful portfolio? I don't think so. I think you can do better than this. And for those of you in the Patreon community, I apologize, I just ran out of time. I didn't have an opportunity to put in Schwab's ETF here, the one that was the best dividend ETF. I should have taken the time to put Schwab in here comparing these two, because we know that Schwab outperformed the S&P 500, but did not outperform my portfolio, though they were relatively close. So I'm gonna go ahead for the members of the Patreon community, I'm gonna throw this spreadsheet up here in the next day or two, but I'm gonna put in there Schwab's data as well to see if you can see an apples to apples comparison between Schwab, between my portfolio, between OUSA and the S&P 500. Hopefully you found some value out of this video, guys. Make sure to leave your 2 cents in the comments below. Someone had a question what I mean by 2 cents. That means leave your opinion down in the comments below. What did you think about the results here? Do you, you currently invest in the OUSA portfolio? And if not, are you gonna start doing it now, or do you prefer to own dividend stocks, or do you just prefer to stick with the S&P 500 here? You know, there's multiple ways to win depending on your goals and strategies here. Make sure to leave your 2 cents in the comments below. That's all I got for you guys. Have a great rest of your day, and please continue to stay healthy, both physically and financially. Have a good one.